We're joined now by our senior advisor for foreign policy and national security, the former acting director of national intelligence, Rick Grinnell. Rick, I want to go to you right away on this development that this former ambassador to Israel from the Obama administration, Dan Shapiro, who joined the State Department. He was a special government employee, so you only get a certain amount of time to do that. But, you know, we know that this deal was supposed to be announced, you know, a couple weeks ago and expected at any time if there is a deal, unless Russia is kind of scuttling that. But then he leaves, and he is the lead person to deal with Israel on this Iran nuclear deal. And he leaves with a statement that says, well, he supports it today. If and when there is a deal, which remains uncertain, I'll have more to say then. What do you read into that, Rick?
He's clearly frustrated. He claims that he's not frustrated, that there's no policy differences, and that he's just leaving. But as an advisor, former ambassador to Israel, as an advisor on these issues, he shouldn't be leaving before we know what the JCPOA deal is. We keep hearing that it's close, that the Russians are being very clear that the Iranians got more than what they thought, that the American negotiators were weak. This is going to be a disaster. He's abandoning ship. I don't care what he says. You don't leave right before a historic agreement if you think the historic agreement is going to be good.
You know, one of the things about this, Rick, that's interesting here is that, as you said, you know, here you've got the Israel whisperers, as Dan Shapiro was called, getting ready to leave or in the process, I guess, has left. And at the same time, like you said, the deal's about to be structured, but the deal is also being negotiated with the Russians' active engagement. And I, for the life of me, cannot figure out what the administration is possibly thinking here. The president called for Putin to be removed from the presidency of Russia. He walked it back, sort of.
It's probably one of the reasons that Dan Shapiro is jumping ship. Again, we have to be clear. He says that there's no policy disagreement. But that's the old Washington line. And what I find really interesting is that the entire JCPOA 2, whatever this negotiation is, everyone is classifying this as the Americans were weak. It gives the Iranians, the Iranian regime, a whole bunch more. And what does Dan Shapiro do when he leaves? He immediately announces that he's going to be working on the Abraham Accords, which is a signal that he is going to do everything he can to be pro-Israel while this deal that he's been working on, this group of people within the Biden administration, is cutting a deal that's going to be anti-Israel, anti-American, and very pro-Iranian regime. He's jumping ship to save his reputation. That's very clear.
Rick, I want to turn to something very important right now, which is what's happening, you know, in Ukraine and with Russia, because a top U.S. general, this is the U.S. European Command Chief General Todd Walters, was asked by Senator Wicker in a hearing, a congressional hearing, if there was an intelligence gap that caused the U.S. to overestimate Russia's strength and underestimate the Ukrainian defenses. And he responded that there could be, and that as they've done in the past, when it's over, when this battle is over, they will do a review. I mean, you come directly from the intelligence world. We all heard similar reports. I mean, there was wide agreement that if Russia decided to invade Ukraine, when they ultimately did it, that it would be over with very quickly. And there was then something very different began happening on the ground.
Look, it is some sort of intelligence failure. Maybe it's an intelligence failure from the newsrooms of Washington, D.C. But you are correct, Jordan, that there was a groupthink in Washington that Ukraine would fall in 2 or 3 days. You had Joe Biden, literally, let's remember, Joe Biden's first policy was, let's get the president of Ukraine out. Remember, he offered him a ride. Let's get you out of the way. This is gonna be such a bloody, terrible war for Ukraine. Let's get you out of the way. And the Ukrainian president said, no, I'm staying here. The intelligence failure here we have to dive into, because even if there were certain aspects of a intelligence analysis that said, well, the Russians aren't up to what they once were, and maybe this will be an even-handed war. If there was intelligence like that, that information did not leak out and the media did not report it. The media did a groupthink absolutely across the board talking about these leaks from the intelligence agencies that Ukraine would get defeated in a couple of days. I just tweeted out this morning the latest of groupthink on intelligence issues from the Washington, D.C. press corps. You see it from multiple sources, CNN, NBC, ABC. They're now all saying the same thing, that Putin is mad at the underlings at his Defense Department, that they didn't give him the right information and that he didn't realize they were losing. All of this is just leaks for partisan purposes, and I'm very uncomfortable with it. The media need to be more skeptical.
I want to go back to the Iran situation for a moment. We have filed a series of, and Rick, you've helped us on these in the past, Freedom of Information Act requests, Andy, dealing specifically with Iran and Israel.
Yes, we have. And, you know, within his first month in office, as we told you, President Biden sort of quietly notified, but distinctly notified Congress to distribute $125 million in U.S. taxpayer-funded aid to terrorist funding Palestinian Authority to reportedly, quote, regain their trust and goodwill after the Trump-era cuts. Now the president is continuing his policy of appeasement of the Iranians by doing so, and of the Palestinians, I might say, yep. Of the Palestinians both. And we have responded by filing two Freedom of Information Act requests, Jay. I'll be happy to go into those if you'd like.
Well, we can do that. We'll do that later in the broadcast because we only got Rick for a few minutes. But I think the point is, Rick, when we do this, I want people to understand, we don't just talk about it here. You're writing about it. We're discussing it. We're broadcasting it. But, Rick, we're also taking action on these things.
Look, so many of us and you know, frustrated conservatives sit around and complain. And we look at the news and we complain and we say, oh, there they are taking the Houthis off the terrorist list. There they are funding more terrorists. They're funding the Palestinian Authority programs, and we know there hasn't been a Palestinian election since 2005, right? Mahmoud Abbas is on his 15th year of his five-year term. All of this is important information, but we can't just complain. What we have to be able to do is dig deep and use our legal resources to question the U.S. government, ask for information, probe, get the information to prove what's happening. All of this highlights the problems. We can't do this without partners. And so I know we've had these discussions about all of these great ideas that we can do. We can't pursue everything because we don't have unlimited funds, but we fight about the priorities. This is a priority.
Yep.
This impacts national security for the United States. I hope people realize that when we put the legal team on this, it's to get to the bottom of it. It's to get to the truth and get the truth out.
Exactly right. Jordan?
Yeah, I mean, and getting back to this, the truth, and getting the truth from the Washington, D.C. or the mainstream media machine, Rick, you tweeted out today that there's the Washington Post put out this tweet. A Post review of Hunter Biden's deals with a Chinese energy company confirms key details and offers new documentation. You said there's nothing new here. We've known this for years, but they ignored the story before the 2020 election to protect Biden, and that there is a crisis with, I think it goes back to the Russia story, goes back to all of this reporting in by media manipulation.
One of the ways that the media manipulates stories is they don't do stories. They don't highlight issues. And we've seen that. The Hunter Biden laptop story, which, by the way, we got to keep saying this, the Chinese government wants everyone to think it's Russian disinformation. They don't want people looking inside that laptop to find out the Biden family ties to China and Ukraine companies. This is a, you know, 10% for the big man moment. Who's the big man? All of this information was known before the election. Reporters ignored it. That's how they use their bias. That's how they manipulate. And now the Washington Post is trying to put something in their archives to be like, oh, this is a problem. Yeah, they're years late. Nothing is new. We've known this. They're playing catch up.
Rick, as always, we appreciate you on the broadcast.